Hey y'all, this is Troy Black. So I got an interesting vision about a toucan bird in October. And when I got this vision, it was very distinct. If you do not know anything about visions or prophecies and things like that, if you're not into that kind of thing, it can seem very weird. I know that. But if you are a Christian, I do encourage you. And if you're in that place, it's weird for me sometimes, okay, still. But if you're in that place, I encourage you to go read the Old Testament, read the prophets, and see how weird it gets in the Word of God, in the Bible, especially with the book of Ezekiel. I read that book recently, and it blew my mind, and I said, this is nuts, okay? So I encourage you to do that. But this was a very weird and interesting vision I got, because most of the visions the Lord gives me, I'm just seeing images. You know, usually I've got my eyes closed. On a few occasions, I've seen things with my eyes open. Most of the time, eyes closed, I'm not hearing anything, but this time I actually heard what I was seeing as well at the same time. So I closed my eyes, I was praying, I was worshiping the Lord, and I saw this very clear image of a toucan bird, and then I heard the toucan bird opens its mouth and starts to talk, and I heard what sounded like what you would imagine a cartoon bird's voice to be like. You know, and this is what it said. It said, political upheaval in Venezuela. So if you're watching this and you go, oh, Venezuela doesn't apply to me, I believe the Lord has given me this word specifically as a right now word for the United States as well. So if you are a believer and you're in the United States, I believe this applies directly to you as well. I also heard the word massive. So this is something that I believe is a big deal, a massive political upheaval. And you know, whatever that might look like. And so as I kept praying, usually I'll pray and ask the Lord if he'll give me a timeline for things, because I want to know when something is going to happen. And I felt like what he dropped in my spirit in that moment was a two-year timeline. And what I believe that means is that we are going to see the negative effects of this occurring more and more over the next 2 years. So after getting this word, I went and I did some research. I looked up Venezuela and I found out that they do have toucan birds. I didn't know that. But I also looked up their political history, and I found that I had no knowledge of this country whatsoever. And what I found was that they have a history of political upheaval. Like, this has been going on in the 90s, recently, you know, in the 2000s. Like, this is something that has happened over and over. And this country has gone from bad to worse, you know, economically and politically in many different ways. So they have this history of political upheaval and instability. But also in 2019, this situation occurred where these two men who were trying to become the next president of that country got into this struggle to see who would be president, and they're still in that struggle today. The question has not been answered. You know, and obviously one of them is the acting president, acting like the president right now. But even around the world, the different opinions of different countries still have not fully agreed on who the president should be. And so this is where I believe this word applies to the U.S. I do believe we need to be praying for Venezuela. And if you are in Venezuela right now, I believe this word applies to you as well. But I also believe God, the Holy Spirit spoke to me on December 20th of 2020, just a few days ago before I filmed this video. And what he said was, talking about this vision, I was praying about this vision and saying, Lord, what do you want me to share in regards to this? And he said, these two words, he said, righteous anger. And at first this didn't seem to fit together, but the more I prayed about this, the more the Lord showed me what he meant. What I believe God is saying is that in the body of Christ, not everyone necessarily, but in general, we have traded the righteous anger that God wants us to have for the anger of man. I want to read this verse. This is James 1:20. It says, for the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. The anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. So I am not getting on this video and speaking out against truth. I'm not speaking out against the truths in God's word at all. I'm not speaking out against, you know, what is right in our culture or our society or in the world right now, what the right thing to do. I'm not speaking out against that at all. What I believe the Holy Spirit is asking me to share right now, though, is the same thing that Romans 12:18 says. It is, if possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. So I'm not telling you that we should not speak out about truth. But what I'm saying is, we need to remember that the word says a gentle answer turns away wrath. And so if we are trying to speak out for the sake of truth, and yet we're doing it in a way that we're leaning on our anger, you know, the anger inside of us, instead of leaning on the righteousness of God, then we're going to be contributing to the problem. As much as we may be wanting the world to know what God says about something, if we're not willing to say it in the way that the Holy Spirit is leading us to say it, then we've missed his heart in the process. And this is why I personally believe God gave me this word right now. And it is that the Holy Spirit does not want us as the body of Christ, when we are trying to stand up for truth and for what is right, he does not want us to unnecessarily contribute to a rise in political issues in whatever country we call home. Look at the way that Paul states this in Ephesians 4:15. He says, "But speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in all aspects into him who is the head, that is Christ." Paul is saying you should speak the truth, but you should also know that when you're speaking the truth, it's most effective when spoken in love, with a heart of love for other people. Not just a heart of love for God and for his word, but a heart of love for everyone, no matter if they agree with us or not. There's a really cool passage in the Bible. This is part of the story where Jesus is in the garden and he's praying, and the mob is about to come arrest him, to take him, you know, to put him on trial and eventually crucify him. And when they show up, you see two responses. You see a response that is being motivated by the anger of man, and then you see a response that is being motivated by the righteousness of God. And the anger of man response is from our friend Peter, you know. He usually responds this way in scripture up until the point where he gets filled with the Holy Spirit. But what Peter does in that moment is he knows that Jesus is the Messiah. He knows that Jesus is doing what God has called him to do. He knows that Jesus is speaking the truth, but he also pulls out his sword in that moment and he starts to lash back at the mob with a motivation of anger in his heart. And then we see the contrast. The way that Jesus responds is, Jesus in that moment was so full of the Holy Spirit that as soon as he said something, I'm gonna read this. It's John 18:6. It says, "So when he said to them, 'I am he,' they drew back and fell to the ground." They drew back and fell to the ground. This is something that I think we miss in scripture a lot. They were so in awe of the glory of God that was being revealed through the man Jesus Christ that they could not even approach him in this moment. So these are the two responses Jesus has. Number one, he displays the glory of God. And number two, he went with them and he laid his life down for us. And what I believe the Holy Spirit is saying right now, he is not saying this to be mean. He's not mad at us. He's saying it with a heart of grace and love. But he's saying that as the body of Christ, we have lost the glory of God to an extent because we're not walking in the Spirit of God. And I, a couple days ago when I was praying about this, I got another vision and I just saw this long room and there were these two tables that stretched all the way down the room. And on each of the tables were just dozens and dozens of computers, you know, almost like two sets of computers facing separate directions. And there were people sitting at all these computers. And what I knew when I saw this was they were at war with each other. It wasn't a physical war, but it was an online war. You know, they were battling back and forth with their words on these two sides of the room. And what I believe the Holy Spirit was trying to tell me in that moment is that persecution will come. When you are speaking up for the truth, yeah, people are going to attack you. But just because persecution comes, even online, you know, on social media, no matter where it is, that does not give us the right to stop acting Christ-like. It doesn't give us the right to stop acting like our Savior. This is what Jesus says in Matthew 5:44. "But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you." Jesus tells us that persecution is going to come, but he also tells us the response that we should have is a response that is motivated by the love of God that is in our hearts, the love that's poured out by the Holy Spirit himself. So when we are walking in the Spirit and we're listening to the voice of the Holy Spirit, when we're letting the Word of God saturate us and lead us, that's why I read so many verses in this video, in this short video, because the Word of God is our life. You know, it's our daily bread that we need. And when we are not being saturated with the Word and we're not walking in the Spirit, you know, and we're not letting Jesus Christ be our head, be our leader. We're going to be responding with our own anger instead of the righteousness of God. So I'm going to finish with this. This is what the Holy Spirit gave me right before I sat down and started filming. I'm going to read this. This is the price we pay for declaring the truth of God through a lens of our own anger. We lose the chance to share the gospel with someone who really needs it.